Alright.
Yeah, I'm doubling down, but a complete second SLS setup. First one works so well, and I promised I will keep reinvesting everything I earn to make stuff of higher and higher quality for you all. If you're new here, I'm making those AirPods protection cases that add a USB-C port to old Lightning models, and I'm producing them here in Switzerland. The cases are all 3D printed using this really awesome SLS technology that uses very fine nylon powder. Why did I get a second printer? Well, let me show you. So yeah, I did all this just to be able to print in white. But it's more important than you'd think. In my first video on SLS technology, in this admittedly clickbaity titled video, I did not in fact buy a $1 million 3D printer. But God forbid I tried to get as many people as possible interested in engineering. I had actually purchased a setup that was 17 times cheaper than that, but that printed just as good. So we had the $1 million 3D printers that only huge companies could afford, and then came the new generation of printers that was now affordable to small companies like mine. But this new generation of printers, they all have one main difference with the more expensive ones: the color of powder that was used. They all use this dark gray powder, and now that I saw that Formlabs pushed the boundaries again by enabling this printer I've got to print in the new white nylon 12 powder, I got super excited, because white parts mean parts in any colors. But more on that later. Let me show you what changes in this new setup compared to what I showed you in the previous video. So it's exactly the same model of printer as my other one, but this time I need to hook up a nitrogen generator to it. I did so much research to get the best possible thing for the cheapest price, and I ended up going with this one that was recommended by Formlabs. It's from Denmark, a company called Flermo, and I love it because it's designed to be a plug and play unit that is sized to be as small as possible to give enough nitrogen for one fuse printer. So usually you generate nitrogen by having a compressor hooked up to a hairdryer, which is then hooked up to a PSA unit. PSA stands for pressure swing absorption, which is basically a system that uses special carbon materials that trap the roughly 20% of oxygen from the air we breathe in while letting the nitrogen pass through. I've already got a compressor, so I thought the most cost-effective way would be to get the dryer and the PSA unit, but then I realized it would be such a mess with all this tubing, and it didn't make much financial sense. This little unit has everything integrated inside the box, and it took me just a few minutes to set up, literally just plug and play. I got the optional display that shows me the amount of trace oxygen at the output, just to double check that everything works well. Now it runs continuously next to the printer. That's pretty much all that changes from printing. Now, I've talked at length already about why I choose SLS over other printing technologies. It's just the best. But today I want to compare the nylon 12 white powder to the gray powder I'm using with the other printer. The gray powder is 9% cheaper, and it takes 40% less time to print a full build chamber compared to using the white powder. That doesn't really bother me, as I can just incentivize people to get the dark gray version by making it a dollar or two cheaper. I was really surprised to see that it printed my existing files without any issues. The color isn't a perfect white, it's got a little blue tint to it. As always on this channel, we turn problems into solutions, and I'll call that color Arctic White. It's a feature, not a bug. And honestly, I'm grateful it's got a blue tint to it and not a yellow one, which would have looked like old plastic. I've left a part in front of the window since my first print a few months ago, and it's still got the blue tint, no yellowing inside. Regarding post-processing, the loose powder is slightly more tricky to recover from the part, but still very manageable. I'm getting ready to launch the new cycle of products, so I've made some homemade upgrades like this fixed brush setup with a foot pedal. That would just help to speed things up and with finger fatigue. For the last step, blasting, the compressor I recommended last time is slightly underpowered but can still work. For the time being, I hooked up a second smaller one in parallel just to increase my air output. By the way, I'm also doing so many improvements on the electronics side. I improved manufacturability and reliability by going from a two-part PCB to now just one part. Thanks to PCBWay for making those, they're really awesome and it's super easy to order from their website. I'll also have a lot more machines to show you, but that'll be for the next time, so please consider subscribing if you're interested. Okay, that's it for the white powder, but now comes the happy part. Colors. Once you've got white parts, you can in theory dye them to achieve any color you'd like. Again here, I don't want to waste time reinventing the wheel, I want something that just works. But here comes the problem when we are venturing in an industry that had a usually very high barrier to entry, gatekeeping. There's so little public information online, it's crazy. So we've got those machines that cost an organ, and I actually know someone who has one and they don't even like them so much. Of course they use vendor locked color cartridges. Then I found this machine with proprietary tech that was about $5,000 that looked interesting but a bit dodgy. More on that later. Then we have the very DIY version using an ultrasonic cleaner, a sous vide cooker or pressure pot, and some off the shelf dye used for clothes. The usual recommended dye brand is RIT, and I saw some comments that the dye more for nylon is good, so that's what I got. I could not for the life of me get a good result. You see, it always had those random spots, no matter how long I left it in there. I thought I had contaminated the parts with hen oil, so I reprinted everything and only handled them with gloves, but same results. Okay, so I found this Formlabs white paper, and in there they recommend a slightly different version of the RIT dye, and they give more instructions. But to be honest, they're talking about dyeing the parts for around 30 minutes, and it feels like I'm not using the right tool for the right job, especially since the RIT stuff doesn't seem to be UV resistant. I want the strong stuff, and it needs to be affordable. So I dove further into the subject and found this video from 6 years ago that looked very promising from a French company. So I called them, they were super nice, but then nothing. Aw man, I practically had to beg them to place an order. You're gonna send emails, fill out Excel sheets, just make a web shop. Anyway, my order finally arrived, so let's try it out. 1 volume of dye for 9 volumes of water. Heat this up to 80 degrees Celsius. I'm using this cheap ultrasonic cleaner, by the way, costs about $100. I started with this 10 liter version, but I found it to be a bit too big to make tests and small batches. So I got this 6 liter version now, which is perfect. Okay, so I'm gonna run a few tests and I will show you the results. First impression is just wow. That's exactly what I was hoping for. You can see that the color gets darker the longer you leave it in there. But it's so quick. I wanted to get light colors for this test, so I think I will stick to the 30 seconds or 1 minute version. I'm really impressed. I did see one comment of someone saying they weren't using those dyes because of the smell, and yeah, it stinks. I recommend doing this outdoors or with some type of air extraction system, maybe a setup similar to the ones used for resin printers, but I was especially worried that the final parts would smell too, but no smell at all. That's what matters for me. The price doesn't seem crazy, but I haven't been doing it for long enough to give you information on the refresh rate and how much it ends up costing per pot. Here are some numbers that they gave me, which might help you get an approximation. So to summarize, you dip your parts in for however long you want. Here I'm putting a 60 second timer. You keep stirring the part and then you rinse it immediately in clear water. Once I'm done with all the parts, I just leave them in a food dehydrator at 70 degrees Celsius for an hour to dry them. I also tried to dye the parts made with the dark gray powder, and here are the results. That deep purple color is very cool. I'm gonna start stocking it too. By the way, the white cases and a few colors are now available on my new shop, opsoless.com. Now some extra tips. I wouldn't leave the dye in the ultrasonic cleaner unless you use it every day. Just pour it back in a jug and store away from sunlight. Then you give it a good shake when you want to reuse it. And only use stainless steel tools. I tried emptying the tank with this tube and well, that's how it ended up. I think I'm gonna have 1 ultrasonic cleaner per color, just so I don't need to worry about cross-contamination between dyes. It's hard to fully clean the tank, so if I can avoid doing that, it's great. I really like this method because it's cheap, it scales up easily. Now I'm using the 6 liter cleaners. I showed you the 10 liter version, but you can get it to any size really. Here's a 30 liter for example. Wait, that one looks oddly familiar. That's right, that's the $5,000 proprietary tech dyer. Turns out it's just a sous vide cooker that you can get on Alibaba for $250. New video coming very soon. Thanks for watching.